The Los Angeles Religious Education Congress is an opportunity for artists of the Catholic world to share their talent and art with the people and the church of the world. The lobby of the arena becomes an exhibit hall where the artist's work is displayed and where attendees can come into contact with the artist and his work, read about the inspiration, the background, the stories that compel and make the art come alive. We are here at the exhibit hall of the Los Angeles Religious Education Congress with this year's featured artist. We welcome Lalo Garcia. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Thank you for having me.
And thank you for accepting this invitation to talk to us about this journey, which is art. How did you first become an artist? When did you know that art, that artistry was your calling?
Well, it's, I have to say that 12 years ago, and this might sound funny to you, but I became what I would call a responsible artist, or an artist with a responsibility of what you just mentioned, a vocation. Mm-hmm. I think that I've been painting all my life. Mm-hmm. I've been doing work for now 30 years. But when I encounter this contemporary style that you are seeing, is when finally I think I found my own very personal and original language. And I began to really search within myself to tell the story, how I felt it, in my own words, which is painting.
And how would you describe your art? Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow the camera to pan this amazing work, which is called This Is My Body, This Is My Blood. And this is one of many that is featured in this exhibit. There's a juxtaposition of the sort of the modern, the contemporary, and some traditional elements, and your choice of color is very interesting. Your choice of geometric shapes is also very interesting. How do you describe this art?
I don't know if I can describe it, and you know, that probably might be the job of a historian or an art critic. It is just something that I always, and I probably will always call it a miracle. Mm-hmm. I truly feel like in the search of finding my own original style, my own personal way of expressing myself, I feel like one day the ceiling just opened in my studio and a light came in, and I found this. I encounter this style. So at this point, I really wouldn't know how to describe it. Mm-hmm. Basically, I can tell you that I am very much in love with the line, the simplicity. Yes. I try to, like they say in journalism, mm-hmm. Less is more. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to create something that is simple.
Yes.
As a challenge, as an artistic challenge. I had been painting in a traditional realism with a lot of detail, a lot of color, and yet this is basically how you would start almost any painting.
Right.
It's your very, very first sketches of a composition. And also, at the same time, I wanted to somehow not recreate, but give it a feel of the iconography, the Byzantine iconography,
right.
where facial expressions are not found, but the story is told through body movement, through a corporal movement. And so I eliminated the face, and for one of the reasons, it gives the viewer the opportunity to really put in your own face. We all have these images of
so
saints,
striking. Yes.
Of you know, the Jesus himself, Mary, but we all have that in our own minds, and this basically gives you that opportunity of you making the face that you want. And even though it's the same circle with just the nose, and I use that basically to direct your view or direct your side wherever I want your side to go. But because they're faceless images, again, it's you complete it.
And they're
you
so provocative. It. I think that one of the most salient aspects is, as we can see in this piece here, this is Jesus in the garden praying, and he is absolutely weeping at the prospect of what's to come. He's asking for that moment of release so that he doesn't have to carry this burden. We see the apostles, you know, they succumb to the fear and to that sense of hopelessness, and they're just exhausted, and so they can't keep up. But any one of those could be us. Any one of those figures could be our own journey of letting go. And how did that first idea first come to you?
Well, it started with the Last Supper, and definitely I wanted to create the enough series for the Passion of the Lord.
Right.
And as you were mentioning this piece, a lot of the times we find images in the market that I felt really did not convey the story. I mean, specifically that one. I mean, that was his worst night.
Right.
I mean, he sweated blood.
Yes.
And yet, you go out there and you see a lot of postcards where he's kneeling and he's like so calmed.
Right.
You don't feel the pain.
Right.
You just don't feel it. So I wanted the viewer to really come in there and meditate and reflect over the scene or over the subject matter, so that you can have a dialogue with the painting, and hopefully that the painting all of a sudden becomes a background.
Yes.
That it bounces right back into you.
And the image we're seeing right now, which is the Pietà, I think this is so masterful because, number one, Mary is not looking down in desolation. She's looking to the heavens because there's almost a sense that she knows that the Son of God has this redemptive out of this world mission, and that she's carrying him. And the richness of the color, that sort of dusk 3 p.m. moment where she has God's Son in her hand. I mean, this is, how did this idea of the faceless Mary looking up come to you?
It's, as you mentioned, most Pietas, obviously, she is looking down, and it would be obvious that she would be looking down at her son.
Right.
But again, part of the other inspiration was my grandmother and my mother, who were extremely strong women. And Mary, a lot of the times, is not depicted visually as that strong woman, and
right.
I wanted to do that,
right.
Where she knew from the minute that he was born, she already knew the end, and she bare with that end. And so when she is offering, her only son to the Creator and letting go. And I remember my grandmother, and I remember my mother, she raised us for 15 years by herself, and I never heard her complain.
Right.
It was, God wanted it this way.
Yeah.
And this is the way it is.
And your grandmother lost both husbands.
Both husbands. And
right.
The same thing, she never complained. And so, I felt that strength, and I compare it to Mary's, and basically to any woman.
Yeah.
I mean, the woman definitely is the strongest.
And that leads us to this image that we have here. This is your theme of Our Lady of Guadalupe as she sort of presides over and looks upon Juan Diego being baptized, this man who at 50 years of age has this holy mission of really being an evangelizer to an entire continent and to bringing Mary to the people of the Americas. What drew you to this idea of highlighting Juan Diego and his baptism?
Well, it's as a Guadalupano, like most Mexicans, and I have really been passionate about this particular theme of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And well, you know, those 4 days of the apparitions overtook the whole story.
Yes.
And I mean, such an important event for him that a lot of people don't focus on, that he was baptized 7 years before the apparitions. And yet, I've only found a couple of murals done in Mexico City where I didn't see him depicted as that. I mean, it's our first sacrament, right, and a faith. And so I wanted to depict the Juan Diego, you know, which has been baptized. And in this particular piece, I could imagine Our Lady of Guadalupe already in the heavens, just overlooking him, mm-hmm, being baptized. So it's that story, so that we don't forget that that he was a Christian before Our Lady of Guadalupe actually spoke to him.
That's very powerful. I think that one of the great things that you do as an artist is that you combine different elements and you fuse a play of words onto your art. And that leads me to this other piece, which is really the birth of Jesus. And in Spanish, dar a luz, to give light, is the literal translation. In Spanish, that means to give birth. And this representation of the birth of Jesus, I think, is quite stunning for many reasons. The first of which is the fact that he is the light, and Mary is carrying the light and bringing the light to the world. And another great thing that we see here is that Joseph and Mary are all of equal stature, because a lot of times we forget the important role that Joseph played in the Sacred Family. How did you come up with this idea?
Well, it's you know, having been at the birth of my five children, I guess it's the idea of having the men behind Mary. At that point, it's only the only thing we can do. I mean,
right,
when you're in the delivery room, you probably feel the most helpless individual in the world, because there's nothing you can do. But yet, you can have that support. You can give that support to your wife at that moment. But as far as the title goes, and you know, you're right, Jesus is the light of the world. In the delivery room, when the child is being born, that just completely transforms itself with light, because
yes,
a new member in the family is coming through, and that little baby just completely changes everything, just like Jesus did.
Change the world.
Yes.
And then the two sort of almost anchoring pieces. One of the great things that I read is that these little figurines that we have here are basically different body parts. And in Mexican culture, or in Latin American culture in particular, when someone is, let's say, if I have a heart problem, I would take one of these charms, one of these like heart charms, and I would take it to one of the my local church and maybe offer it to one of the saints as a promise. You know, I'll do this if you intercede for me to God so that I can heal from my hands, back, or whatever. Why do I, as a Mexican, not know this? Why is this kind of like a lost, you
well,
know, custom?
It's you know, one of the things that I keep telling teachers is that even for us Americans, mm-hmm, to get to know Jesus better, mm-hmm, is we need to know a little bit more about the Jewish culture.
Mm.
Faith and culture go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it comes to Our Lady of Guadalupe or that particular piece, if we don't know very much about the culture, a lot of things are going to not make sense.
Yes.
So because it becomes a popular devotion.
Mm.
And so those charms, you find them in every plaza, in front of every church, because it's part of what keeps the fiestas going. This is why traditions will never die, because it's an ongoing thing.
Right.
And so those milagros you find, you know, throughout the country, and that's really what people do because they believe in it. And it's more of a cultural devotion rather than a religious devotion, something very, very regional that happens. So, you know, people who are involved in dance, for example, know exactly what those means, because it's part of the rituals of the peoples as a cultural devotion that they have.
And I think that you really encapsulate that in this final piece that we're going to view. This is the Good Shepherd. And I love this image because, you know, it's so interesting to me. The sheep aren't white. And I think that that is symbolic of the fact that we as his sheep, we're not immaculate and perfect, that we are somehow tarnished a little bit by life's scars and by the experiences, and that somehow the shepherd, just as we are, he takes us and we are in his image. And I love the texture. How did you achieve the texture on the sheep?
The texture is marble dust, or okay, sand, you might say. And basically, I wanted to retell the parable of the Good Shepherd, and I'll tell you into a little secret here.
What's the secret?
Basically, everybody knows the parable. Well, I'm that shepherd, and those are my sheep. Mm. These three sheep that you see are my three daughters, my two sons, and my two granddaughters. Mm. And their names are inscripted in, this is Dulce.
Oh, yes.
Dulce, Bella, wow. Feli. You can see my granddaughter says Angelica.
Ah, that is so masterful.
They know me. I know them. Ah. I take care of them. That's exactly what the shepherd does. So you are a shepherd at times, and you are sheep at times. Mm. So basically, what I would want to tell people through this is that we are all shepherds, and that we our duties is to take care a lot of the times whoever is around them in different many ways. Mm. And again, is to meditate over the parable, go into depth as in the other pieces. But this is one piece that I think we can really interpret a very personal, and so the parable hopefully would become more familiar to us and a little bit more serious to us.
We thank you so much for taking the time to share your story, to share your inspiration, and to really be that beacon of light and of gift to the people of the Church of Los Angeles and of the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alex, and the privilege.
Thank you.